Okay, as soon as everyone gets in, we'll get going.
Mr. Sparks again. John Sparks comes to us with a wealth of knowledge, former nominative command sergeant major, also a former training and doctorate command sergeant major, and also, I'm going to brag on him a little bit, the father of the Institute for Non-Commissioned Officer Professional Development, the College of the American Soldier, and is a true advocate and has been and always will be a true advocate for the enlisted education and professional development system for the United States Army. He has more time and energy and knowledge on this subject than all of us put in the room. And we have the current and the former TRADOC Sergeant Major. He's been working diligently to advance our non-commissioned officer education system for over a decade. He continues to do that every single day, and now he's working the strategic future for what we do. Okay, and I'm gonna let him shape and frame exactly what he does, and you'll see the value of what he does every single day. So without further ado, Mr. John Sparks.
Hey, thanks, SMA. We're gonna talk about education first, and I'm gonna tell you how we got there. I'm going to tell you the process that we went about to change our education system to, I think, represent what we need the most in the nominative sergeant major world. I'm proud to say I am on my last job, so I will not be calling anybody to help me out. I might call you, Sergeant Major Schroeder, just for the heck of it, just to call you.
But I like talking to you.
I do too. Also, the SMA said he was a TRADOC Sergeant Major, Sergeant Major Davenport's a TRADOC Sergeant Major. Would you all agree with me that we get uglier every year as a TRADOC Sergeant Major? I'm trying to be helpful, Sergeant Major.
You want to play? Don't bring it over here, man. You know better.
You see the attitudes just flow up here. The SMA, when I came on to take this job, the SMA sent me out to really interview the Army on what's important about a nominative sergeant major. Now, you know as well as I do, we didn't do a good job really quantifying that for years, which really has a negative effect on what you do, what you get, how you act, who you are, and what comes your way. So what we did is we interviewed a whole bunch of general officers. We interviewed about 31 to date, and we didn't just sit down and give them a questionnaire and say, fill this out, let us know what you think. Sat down for an hour and a half, 2 hours with them, and said, let's talk about sergeants major and general. And then a like number of nominative sergeants major. We would sit down with the general and then sit down with the sergeant major, and some occasions just the sergeant major, some occasions just the general. What was amazing is how alike they were in what they thought sergeants major should do. So we took all that data, we rolled it up, and we took a hard look at what we were doing currently in our nominative education. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you what we were doing, then I'm going to show you what we are doing, and then we'll talk about it a little bit. So next slide, please. This is the guidance the SMA gave. Sergeant Major Davenport and the SMA have worked really hard on the step process, and we're all here as we go through. If you have any deliberate questions about anything that's on the slide for me or anything that feeds onto the slide, sound off, because we've got a lot of experience. And don't hesitate to ask a question. You don't have to wait to the end. I don't care what you ask. It can be the hardest, meanest, angriest question you got, and we'll take it on. So anything you see in there that prompts a neuron firing, just sound off, and we'll take a shot at it. One of the things that all the general officers said and all the sergeants major said, third bullet down, is you can't take a person, put them in a nominative sergeant major position, and just leave them there. And then at some point in time in there, decide, hey, we got this slot open for this class, so we're going to send them. Whatever you're going to do, you got to do it up front so it prepares them for the position. Wow, that makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? It's what we've been doing for years for non-commissioned officers. But with sergeants major, we kind of got out away from that. And I see some of you taking pictures of the slides. If you just send me an email, I'm on Global. We'll send it to you if it's not on the AUSA website already. So if you want any of this stuff, just yell.
Hey, John, I'm going to take Matt this post-mortem.
Okay. Great. So it'll be posted there, and if for some reason you have any trouble, you can shoot me an email, we'll get them to you. Questions on this slide? Okay, you can't be sleeping. You got to ask tough questions. Next slide. This is what we were doing. Now, if you look at each and every one of these courses individually, many of you have probably been to them. I would not tell you that they're not good and they're not valuable for something. Most of the situations that are relevant in attendance of these particular courses had to do with an available slot and a general officer course. For example, the Army Senior Leader Development Program, basic, intermediate, and advanced. We would send a very few or small amount of sergeants major to those courses every year. And what would happen in the general officer world, you would go to them sequentially and progressively. You'd go to the basic, then the intermediate, then the advanced. But we didn't do that in the sergeant major world because this year we might get 2 slots for the basic, but 6 slots for the advanced. So we just pluck you out and say, hey, you look available, let's send you. So you'd end up going to the advanced seminar, but never attended the basic or the intermediate. Now, that might have been okay if the education was relevant to what you needed in position. So some of you are in the room, I see your faces. What we did is we took a look at the POI. We managed that or evaluated that against the requirements to be a nominative sergeant major. And then we went back and we talked to previous students. I called them up or I went to visit them and I said, hey, you went to this course a year and a half ago. You're a division sergeant major now. What did it do to help you? Are you any better for going? Did you learn something you didn't know? Generally speaking, most of the time was, great course, I enjoyed being there, but I'm not really getting anything or wasn't anything that's directly applicable to what I'm doing now. Now, there may have been some occasions where there was something, but generally speaking, there was not. So when we looked at this holistically, we looked at it against what's actually in the program of instruction, what's being presented, what are the requirements, the needs of the sergeant major population, and what did the sergeant's major and the general officer say they expected out of a nominative sergeant major? So we used that sort of a wicking technique to determine what we should go to of what we're currently going to and what we should not. Questions? Okay, next slide. Take a look at this. Now, remember, for those of you that have went to the course, or please, don't remember, but look down at the bottom bullet. Because I know you'll say, well, we removed the legal orientation course. Wow, that's terrible. We didn't just remove things. We said, okay, if we're doing this, what of it is applicable to the population that they don't previously get in some other sort of education? And then we look at that to go into another type of education. How the Army runs. If you look at the bottom bullet, it says some courses may still be viewed as broadening. So if we look at a position and say, that particular position needs to go, but not the whole Army, and not every nominative position, then we still send them to that particular course. We don't want to necessarily get rid of everything if there's some application for something that you may need to do. But we certainly don't want to take your 30 months or whatever it is as a nominative sergeant major and send you to school for 6 of it. If those particular things we're sending you to school with don't have a direct impact on what you're actually doing or what you actually will do. We removed the basic, intermediate, and advanced seminars. Those are seminars that were designed for general officers. They're not bad seminars. There is good information. There is a social interaction that occurs between the sergeant's major and the general officers. So sometimes that's important. We still may send particular or specific people to those courses to do 2 things. One, to broaden them, but also give a sergeant major perspective. So there are things that you will continue or you may continue to do, but you will no longer have a situation where you move into the nominative world and you don't really understand what you're going to do. Questions? Next slide. We recommended that we establish a nominative seminar program. Could you go back one slide, please? Just for an example, the senior leader seminar, the ASLDPs, they were all engineered and developed for general officer students. Next slide. The nominative seminar program is developed and engineered for sergeants major. The information that goes into the nominative seminar program comes from the sergeant major of the Army, the senior enlisted council, the reviews and interviews from general officers, and the interviews from sergeants major. We completed our first nominative seminar program iteration 2 weeks ago. The way the process worked, the Sergeant Major Edgar reviews people that are newly in position. He comes up with a list. We take it to the Sergeant Major. We brief the Sergeant Major of the Army on it. He selects the people that are going to attend the course. We notify them, and we conduct the course. Nominative seminar program is based upon current requirements and discussion. Some of you are students that went to the last course in the room. We might tee up an idea. We might spend 2 hours talking about it. Once we determine that we've talked about that enough and we've reached a place that we wanted to get, we tee up the next subject, we talk about it again. So we use a discussion kind of format. Works really well. We're going to talk about that again in a minute. Establish a partnership with a nationally recognized business school. In the civilian world, when you hear about business schools, they're really this, executive education colleges. There's 10 are nationally recognized. There's many business schools, but 10 of them are recognized nationally. We looked at all 10 of those. We developed programs or developed metrics to align and consider what course would be best for the nominative Sergeant Major population. We selected one school, and we sent the first nominative Sergeant Major there last week. So he'll provide feedback. We'll look at that particular program he went to, determine if it was the right thing for us to do, and then we'll move on. And then we've got some discussion about Keystone and how we align that better to serve the Army. We'll talk about that some more, too. Next slide. Okay, read over this NSP real quick. And I'd like to get into just a little more detail. When you first become a nominative Sergeant Major, you're going to get a call or a letter or an email or something that says you've been selected to attend the Executive Leader Course. ELC ran at Carlisle Barracks, Pennsylvania, 2 weeks in duration. And we've retooled the scheduling of that course to facilitate an idea where we can send you before you go into position or very shortly after you're in position. So we've already done that with the first course, or we've done that with one course. We'll do that a couple more times, then we'll step back from it and say, is that really the right thing to do? Do we get you at the right time? We'll call you up after you've been through the course and now you're in a position and say, was that helpful to you? Did we train you right? Did we train you at the right time? So everybody that becomes a nominative Sergeant Major, either before or soon after he's selected for the position, will attend the Executive Leader Course. So you're going to do that for a 1 or 2 star level position. Then you're serving in a nominative position. You're serving in a 1 or 2 star position. You either have been selected, one of the panel members believes that you've got the potential, or you're actually in the new position, then you'll be selected for the nominative seminar program. The nominative seminar program will be no more than 4 days. Remember what the first slide said, we are not going to take you away from your unit for a long period of time. We recognize that you're going to bring as much as you're going to take away from the program. We've had two of the speakers at the program came back and said, wow, I think I got more out of them than they got out of me. We had a time when we were talking talent management. Some of the sergeant majors again are in here. The speaker was writing faster than the students were because the sergeant majors had great perspectives on how to manage talent. So Talent Management Task Force, Headquarters Department of the Army, now they not only gave us what they were doing, but we gave them the perspective from that population on what we think about what they're doing. So it's a discussion format back and forth. But anyhow, you're going to be selected for that after your first nominative position. We're going to try to capture you either right before you take a position or right after. The nominative seminar program is all sergeant majors, dedicated to sergeant majors, and it is so important to the sergeant major of the Army, he spent 2 whole days there. 2 days in the classroom, talking to the students, asking questions, getting feedback, considering ideas, and the TRADOC and the Forces Command sergeant major came there and they stayed, what, 2 or 3 hours were your times. Just in their dialogue and talking to students, taking questions, briefing them on what they're doing. And then we followed up on the last day with the senior enlisted council sitting down with the sergeants majors and just dialoguing back and forth. So it's all about trying to deliver whatever education you think you may want to know and whatever education that we got from those general officer and sergeants major surveys. So the process is to accommodate you, not to accommodate an empty slot that we can put you in. Okay, questions? Next slide. We talked about this just a few minutes ago. Talked about the idea that there might be other educational venues that have something that can help a senior sergeant major. Take a look at that, and I'll talk to you a little bit more about it, and then we'll move on. We did this just last week. We sent the first nominative sergeant major to a college that specializes in executive level education, training people in the civilian world that are senior executive leaders. We sent a sergeant major there to evaluate it for us, to audit it, to tell us if that was the right thing to do. He'll take a couple weeks, digest it, come back to us and say, you know, we should do this, we should consider this, take a look at this. There's two things I want to get out of this particular idea of senior nominative education. The first thing is to provide some sort of education that's commensurate with the level of responsibility that you will have in the next position, whatever that is. We want to do it the best way we can. If the best way is in an Army school, great. If it's not in an Army school, the SMA said, look anywhere. We'll figure out how to fund it. We'll figure out how to work it. So we want the best sort of education we can deliver. That's the first thing. The second thing is we want to give the nominative sergeant major exposure to another environment. Now, I know you're exposed to plenty of different environments, but we want to put you in a school setting, an educational environment, where you're around senior leaders from other types of organizations, civilian organizations. One, it gives you a different perspective dealing with those guys, and two, it might potentially give you some networking capability. So the idea is to look at senior sergeant major for this program, those serving in 3- and 4-star nominative level billets, when they go into position, provide this sort of education at a nationally recognized executive leader school and have it no more than 4 days in duration. Now, are you tracking with me here on the time you're going to be away from the unit? You got 2 weeks at the executive leader course when you first or before you take your sergeant major position or shortly thereafter. There might be some specific education that's related to your position, like how the Army runs that you go to. But the vast majority of you, your next point of education will be the nominative seminar program, away from your unit for 3 to 4 days. And then if you continue to progress, then you're going to attend senior nominative education, probably at an executive leader school, probably that specializes in training civilian leaders, and probably for no more than 4 days. And then after that, there might be some special education that the SMA identifies or designates for a particular position. Questions? Next slide. Okay. The panel is up here. That's Sergeant Major Dennis Edgar. I don't know if you know the kind of different looking dude on the right hand side. We're going to stay up here for a couple minutes. What I'd like you to do is open up your aperture. Anything that we said, that Sergeant Major Tom, Sergeant Major Edgar, I said, you question and challenge. From my lane, the education process only works if we do it right, and we have you in mind. So if you've got a comment or a question or a concern, sound off. There's nothing, we're not hiding anything, we don't have any agendas. We simply want to provide the best opportunities for you. From my lane, the best education. Okay, the floor is yours. Questions?
So, hey, Mr. Sparks, if I could hit something education-wise
that
you touched on so that everybody understands. So, from an ELC perspective, so if you've been selected for your first-time nominative position, right, I schedule you for ELC. So what happens is after selection, you get an email from me saying that you are tentatively scheduled for ELC, all right? That's for you to know, for you to mark your calendar, for whatever. This course is another NCOES or NCOPDS school, meaning if something comes up when you get that email from me that you cannot attend, you don't get to just not attend. So you have to request a deferment, and that has to go up through your ACOM and ASCC and DRUs to say that you want to defer, and then they have to approve it before you're deferred. It's just like any other course. You get promoted and get scheduled for ALC or SLC. You get sent a note that says this is your school dates. If something comes up that you have to be deferred, you got to be deferred. We kind of have a sense out there with ELC with some folks that when they get scheduled, they're like, I'm not going to attend. I'll attend later. You don't understand. There is no later. You go either prior to taking position or as long as the class schedule supports within the first six months of taking position. It is a requirement. Okay, so we got to get away from thinking that it's not really a requirement. That's the first thing. The second thing is Keystone. So I get a lot of calls about Keystone, and so I'm going to post some things up on the website about Keystone. But look, Keystone is driven 100% by the joint staff, okay? And it's based off of Tier 1 and Tier 2 level positions, meaning if you're not on that Tier 1 or Tier 2 list, you don't get to attend Keystone. So I have a lot of folks to call and say, when do I get to go to Keystone? Can you schedule me? Who do I have to talk to? The reality is, if you meet one of those Tier 1 or Tier 2 level positions, I will contact you, and I will say, this is when you're scheduled. Here's the other thing about Keystone. When I tell you you're scheduled, it's the same thing as ELC. You don't get to just not attend, okay? Because the joint staff requirement is, within the first 6 months of taking one of those Tier level positions, you have to attend, as long as the class schedule supports. So it's the same thing. If you think there's a reason why you can't, that's got to go up through ACOM, ASCC, DRE, whoever, for deferment, back to me, and then I have to take it to the joint staff and ask the SEAC if it's okay. And then he gives the final approval as to whether you can be deferred or deleted from that particular course. So Keystone is driven 100% from the joint staff. Run through my office, okay, but definitely done by the Tier 1 and Tier 2 level positions.
Thanks, Armita. Comment?
Hey, just real quick.
You want the mic? You don't want the mic?
I don't know. Well, you know, I was at, you know, I'm looking at the camera. Hey, one, this is better, okay? This is better. I could tell Sergeant Major Davenport sometimes, I say, hey, more is not always better. I mean, better is better, all right? And so this is better. It's less is better. And it's less formal, okay? We're much more flexible with this, and it's tailorable to what we need it to do. Hey, this is the SMA's leader development program for sergeants major. So my message is, hey, what's yours? What's yours at the Corps level? What's yours at the division level? What's yours at the brigade, battalion, and the company troop and battery level? What's our leader development program in our organizations? What's ours? What are we doing to develop our NCOs at all levels? And then I'll say, hey, deferments, on the deferment thing, hey, don't wait. Don't try to solve things and wait till the last minute, because what you're doing is, you could be denying somebody else an opportunity. Hey, anything that is, I have not had a problem with anything where we had enough warning and it made sense to do a deferment, Never had a problem, all right? Where we start to have problems is where we wait till the last minute. And sometimes it's not always the right reason either.
Thanks.
Well, I think that's right. So, again, we as a non-commissioned officer corps have to be committed to lifelong learning. And the way it was set up in the past was once you got to the Sergeant Major Academy, that was kind of it, and the nominative training was hit or miss. So this commits us to lifelong learning as professional non-commissioned officers. It also helps you to start making those decisions about what you want to do. So if you're not getting asked to attend seminar number two, that's probably a good indication you're not very competitive. And so then you can make some decisions about what you need to do next. So all this is trying to be tied together. I think we're on the right track, and I look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Thanks, Amir. Sure, please. I don't want to throw it because, I'm a civilian. You might try to jump on me when I miss.
Still a big guy. I'll leave that alone.
Thanks.
Yes, sir. Sergeant Major.
Wait, he said big guy, not overweight, Sergeant Major. I just want to be clear. Yeah. I'm good.
Good. So, we'll check your ERB.
Yeah, I'm good.
I have a concern is that sometimes we rush to failure. I mean, we don't do a great job as senior NCOs on giving candid feedback on NCOPDS courses, which is why we got rid of the First Sergeant course, right? We had the First Sergeant course. It was NCOES. Everybody complained. We took it out. So now we're bringing it back as the Master Leader course. So my concern is, are we rushing to failure in that we're removing some of these courses that may have value added, and we're only doing it because of the lack of feedback from our peers? I mean, I've been to some of those. I think, you know, How the Army Runs course is exceptional.
Yeah.
You know, Recruiting Command, I don't know if it helps me. I can't speak for everybody, but I just have a concern that we rush to remove things because we're not giving the honest feedback that had for the value added to the course.
Hey, that is a great point. And that should be a concern for everybody. And let me tell you how the process works for looking at courses for relevance, just for example. The SMA first, he said to us, now we didn't just start on this a couple weeks ago. We've been working on it for about a year and a half. First, the SMA said, I want you to understand and digest everything we teach in these courses, and then go to it. So I sat in for the newest HTARS course. So then I came back to the SMA and I gave him feedback. And then Sergeant Major Edgar and I provided all the nominative positions. So we went back and looked at each nominative position and what is the requirement for that particular position. And then we went back and we called previous attendees previous course attendees that were nominative sergeants major. So that process really is living. It continues to go on to determine, is there something out there that's of worth to us? Now, I have no doubt the SMA will be somewhere, and they'll be doing some offhand course that's not in any Army record, and he'll say, John, go out and take a look at that. And I'll take a look at that to see if that has relevance. Now, there are some positions, I don't want to say them all in here, yours may very well be one of them, that will continue to go, because there are some positions that the education is beneficial. And in the event that we make a mistake, the SMA has all the latitude in the world to either remove a position or to put someone else in the position, or to add a position in that particular course. Now, one more thing about your comment. I think, and I know Sergeant Major Davenport will probably relate to it, Sergeant Major Daly could relate to it. In schools, we beg you to do a good end of course critique. Then we beg you to give us feedback after you've been back out in the field. Then there's another process that goes out and talks to the commander after a soldier attends school, so TRADOC can get that feedback and look at their courses and retool it. In the nominative program, what we are doing, and the students that were in nominative seminar one can tell you, at the last day, I told them, you are not going to fill out an end of course critique before you leave here. You are not. I'll tell you why you're not, because I'm going to call you on the phone and schedule an appointment with you. And then we're going to sit down, probably on the telephone, for 30 minutes to an hour, and we're going to discuss your thoughts of the course. After you've left, once you've been back in your unit, when you're not in a hurry, when you don't have, I got to catch this last plane out of Norf, none of that, you're going to have time to sit down and represent what you actually thought and what we could actually do better. And I'm going to ask them prompting questions. And they're going to have plenty of time to give me a response. Then I'm going to take all that data, I'm going to go over to the SMA and say, SMA, this is what they had to say about the last nominative seminar course. These are my recommendations. So that's how this process is going to work. Because I've learned a couple things over the years about how we get your feedback. But one thing I continue to learn, and I don't mind saying it in front of some of the students, some of them are sitting here, I am very excited about the future of the nominative population. I think the people that came in to speak would tell you the same things. We have got some really, really good sergeant majors, and we really owe it to them to give them the best education possible and not waste their time. So we're going to get after it as deliberately as we can to get your feedback and try to put it in the process. And you know how this works. If most of you say the same thing, it's probably pretty reliable. Then we'll put it in the system to validate it and take a look at how we can present that. Okay, does that answer your question, Sergeant Major? Any other questions for anybody here? Anybody up here at the head table or the table on the stage?
If I could, I'd like to
provide the perspective, and John told you the process of how they brings it to me, and ultimately, I'm posed with decision. And I'll explain my rationale, and we'll use that one as an example. Okay, so force management course, it does have an intended audience and an intended outcome. Okay, so it's a specific course designed to train individuals about the knowledge of how the senior functions of the Army run. Okay, so here's the question: does every nominative level sergeant major need that? Question number one, that's what I have to do, and I use the team to help me decide that. Question number two is, okay, was it purpose-built in order for sergeant majors to progressively develop as a leader inside the nominative program? Okay, and then three, what is the cost? Okay, because ladies and gentlemen, at my level, that matters, all right, because I have a budget, and I have to make it work, all right, and in a there's cost in two different types. There's a monetary cost and time, okay? And I can't give that back to commanders. So when we look at all these courses, would it be good to send all the sergeant majors to everything? Absolutely. I mean, in an unconstrained resource environment, in an unconstrained time environment, absolutely. We just send you to all those things. And there's a little bit of benefit for all, okay? But I'll give you an example of what was at the last How the Army Runs course before I made the final decision to say we didn't cut it. Not every nominative sergeant major will attend it as a requirement. There were 37 sergeant majors there. None of them, almost none of them, were nominative. And three of them had retirement orders. Okay, so let's get to cost. Oh, I know, everybody's like, oh, what the hell, sergeant major? Make all these decisions in a vacuum. No, I don't. All right, so let's get to cost. All right, DC, the area that you're in, is one of the most expensive places to bring people TDY. To house them and to feed them per diem, okay? At that same cost of those sergeant majors, and we just ran a pilot, I can send you to one of the leading business schools in America. I'm talking Fortune 500. Yale graduates, Harvard graduates compete to go to these schools, right? They will house you and feed you for 2 weeks, and you will talk to the people that run the billion-dollar organizations in this country that translate to the things that we do, because we're a multi-billion dollar enterprise, right? And you can leave that with a civilian credential that has value in both the Army and the civilian world for the same cost. Ladies and gentlemen, you're the sergeant major of the Army. Make the decision. Do you keep the force management course and make everybody still go? Or do you invest in opportunities to broaden our sergeant majors from a perspective that was never been offered to this community before? You see my point? So those are things we have to take in consideration. If we had an unconstrained, by time and money environment, sure, we'll send everybody to the How the Army Runs course, but that doesn't exist, and we have to tailor education based upon the requirements for the Army and what's in the best interest of the Army and the individual and how we're going to use that individual in the future. David, did you want to comment?
With all that being said, more importantly, it's taught at USASMA. So all sergeants major coming through the Sergeant Major Academy gets How the Army Runs. So there's no need for us to do disposable training. So we do it at USASMA. You actually get more turns and more hands-on than you do at How the Army Runs course. So there's another reason why we don't need it.
Okay. One thing, to pile on the SMA and Sergeant Major Davenport, it's getting things in the right place. We were training previously things for nominative sergeants major that all sergeant majors need to know. So Sergeant Major Davenport says, why would we just train the nominative population on that? Why wouldn't we train everybody on that? So all of these processes are linked. We do every month we do a leader development meeting in the SMA's office. We brief, we link things together. Sergeant Major Davenport's got a very deliberate process of linking all the schools together. So ideally, progressive, sequential, and really the kind of education that will help you be a better nominative sergeant major. Any other questions or comments? Please. Yes, in the back there. Hold on, let me get you a mic.
No.
Here, I got it.
I'll be a runner. I'll be a runner, sergeant major.
I can probably beat him.
Now, Sergeant Major Carter, not pertaining to the nominative, I think I'm clear on that, and maybe everybody else. I'm sure, but since it's the forum, I had to bring up something on the enlisted image and the sergeant major's image across the spectrum from my perspective. As I look out there across the website AKO and ACT, thinking this is going to be my last job, started the transition process, of course. I look out there, how the civilians see us, the enlisted corps. As we look out there, it says, if I look in 25 X-ray, being signal sergeant major, I can get a job as telecommunications. And I can get a basic technician job, something like that. The civilian corps does not see us, I believe, as what we're presumed. We're more educated. We're highly intelligent now. But they do not see us as that out there. And outside, just came from the solo course, and they brought up a slide that says a sergeant major is the equivalent to a GS-6. Mm. I was very disappointed in that right here. But we're highly intelligent. We're getting all this training. And we all know how intelligent we are. We know what we're capable of. And when we start a transition, the civilian sector does not see that. They see what's on there. If we look on the COOL website on there, and we search that, compare what our officers out there, they get all these executive jobs. We're working side by side, but yet we're getting the transition jobs, or the telecommunication maintenance officer, NCO supervisor, something that's probably about $50,000 versus something that's $75,000 to $100,000. How can we get at that issue right there to help the America see how value added we are once we come out? Because we know there's always jobs out there looking for veterans hiring, but so civilians looking at the enlisted corps out here for everything that we've done, if they go to those websites, we say, oh, this is all they do? You know, how can we get at that? My opinion, Sergeant Major.
Oh, no, your opinion is very valued and actually true. It's 100% true. We don't have value to what I call service beyond sacrifice and service. Okay, and I equate it to the fact that every person in America will want to buy you a cup of coffee. Sergeant Major. They'll give you their seat in first class. Happens to me all the time. I don't take it, Sergeant Major, so I know what you're thinking. All right, I don't take it. I promise you I don't. I sit in the back near the latrine. And he's exactly right. All right, and we have not stalled on this, and it is not coming. It's actually happening right now. And let me explain, and I'll ask Dave to elaborate on this. It's critically important, okay? Because there's people that have challenged me on this, and as well as Dave, and there's a strategic future for this. So it's about credentialing. All right, credentialing from two perspectives, from a technical perspective and licensing and credentialing, and also from an academic perspective. And we're working this very hard. Okay, so first and foremost, one thing, all right, and I don't like hearing it, all right, there's a different reason why we're enlisted officers. We're not trying to become officers. That's not the intent. And the pay is associated with the duties and responsibilities, Sergeant Major. So the more educated we become, don't try to equate the fact that just because I have a master's degree, I should get the same pay as my commander. My commander is the chief staff of the Army. He is a member of the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and he has a responsibility to provide strategic input to the defense of the United States of America. I am the senior enlisted advisor. Completely different role, okay? I have a degree just like him. It doesn't matter, all right? So we got to get away from that. But we do have to get, all right, is we have to start making sure that we give you the credit for the things you do, all right? And that's our responsibility. That's the enterprise's responsibility. We're working this very hard. So we're in our second year of implementation at the Sergeant Major Academy of inputting fellows into our Sergeant Major Academy. We got the Deputy Commandant here. I think the Commandant might be in this. The Commandant, he's probably asleep, but the Deputy runs the place anyway. And that's right. Where's? But we're in our second year of fellowship, okay? And the intent is we got to seed this academy with highly trained and educated fellows at the graduate level before we can request. The reason why you don't get credit for the many things you do is for a couple of reasons. One, we don't have the requisite level of education for our facilitators because it's not a requirement for enlisted soldiers. We have built that requirement in the Sergeant Major Academy now, so we'll meet that education requirement of those facilitating the information. And the second, and probably more important, is how we evaluate you. It's not the curriculum, okay? And here's what's going to get tough, and here's what you're going to hate, and here's because we're already starting the Sergeant Major Academy. We're going to go to written assessments, because if you want a degree, Sergeant Majors, multiple choice stopped in eighth grade, okay? If you want a degree, link charts of matching this to this, picture to question, stopped in eighth grade, okay? And it's going to get hard, and there's going to be attrition rates, because that's what we see now.
But if we want the requisite level of education and we want it to be considered and valued by our civilian population, then we have to be tested and evaluated commensurate to it. Okay, and we're working this very hard. Sergeant Major Academy right now is in its second year of implementation. We believe we're going to be fully accredited in 18 months at the graduate level. Okay, Sergeant Major Dave Davenport and his entire team are reevaluating all the Common Core curriculum throughout the entire non-commissioned officer professional development system to get true academic credit. Now, that has to exist in a world that's consistent with our civilian counterparts. You got to be cognizant of the fact that not everybody in those academic institutions have degrees commensurate with the level of education they're providing. And one is how we evaluate it, okay? But we're working this extremely hard. Just from Common Core alone, I think the last time we reassessed, and correct me if I'm wrong, Jeff, I think it's just 100, there's 112 credit hours alone in non-commissioned. So we've raised this up quite a bit, okay? And we got to continue to work hard. And the COEs are doing that. And they're not doing that from two perspectives. One, the education commensurate with the academia, as well as from a credentialing perspective, a licensing and education. Okay, but these come with costs, our major, and the cost is you've got to be academically challenged. Okay, and we have to get in the comfort zone of writing. Okay, so if you've ever been Bloom's taxonomy, and I don't want to get too technical with people here, all right, but you have the very bottom of the pyramid, all right, and that's repetitive tasks. That's what we teach soldiers in basic training. We tell you to do this, march how I do, say what I say, and that's a repetitive task. We need to get to above where the aperture is on Bloom's taxonomy, and it's called critical thinking, and your ability to be able to analyze a situation, and then analyze that in a very comprehensive manner and be able to explain it very thoroughly. At the graduate level, if anybody in here has been at the master's program, okay, how many multiple choice tests did you take the last time your professor sent you a homework assignment, all right? Doesn't happen, okay? So, and that is being integrated throughout the system. So to be truly recognized by our civilian counterparts, the value for what we do in the Army, we have to up the game with inside of our non-commissioned officer professional development system. And we're not trying to earn degrees. That's not the intent here. What we're trying to do is give you maximum credit for the work that you do. Okay? Yes, Sergeant Major.
Sergeant Major, I think there's a piece we're missing. And it goes probably more to the divisions and maybe the brigade and the Corps Sergeant Majors, is that we also have to get out and show them what we do. I acknowledge the accreditation, but just having a credit isn't going to get you that opportunity. So every time that you don't take some kind of engagement into your community, you never show your community what you do. And when you meet with Starbucks and you meet with somebody else and it's just your commander, that's all they know. So every time you hide in the S6 office and the G6 and you don't interact in your community, you're not showing people what a Sergeant Major does. You can have all the credits you want in the world, and they're just going to read what a Sergeant Major did in the Army, said, yeah, you got a credit. But if you don't get out and interact with your community in a positive manner that shows them what a Sergeant Major can do for their company, you're never going to get past that. You can have all the credits in the world, and you're not going to be active in your community, and they're just going to, enlisted guy, you know, you're a technician. That's just my opinion.
Thanks, Sergeant Major.
So I live in a pretty academic world, Army medicine, and you know, I think about this a lot, and the first thing I think about of what Army medicine does for our Army and the people of our Army is first in a capability standpoint. So you know, we've got a lot of opportunities, obviously, in Army medicine. We have lots of civilians that we work with. We work with them every single day. We've been able to build in some programs, some certifying programs, things that enhance the business of healthcare, which make us more efficient, which take care of more of you. I'll talk a little bit about that this afternoon at the readiness panel. But we've been finding ways to wicker in certifications. For instance, the biggest thing on my mind these days is not so much how well we did in saving lives on the battlefield the past 15 years, but how far we have to go in the future. And so just to give you an example of that, you know, 68 Whiskey Combat Medic, second largest MOS in the Army. The first node of that healthcare out on the battlefield, they've got a certification that is not commensurate with the capability that we need in the future. They have a certification that isn't commensurate with getting a good paying job that our lawmakers are concerned about right now through the NDAA and things like that. So I would challenge all of you in your AOC, your MOS, to find ways in which you build capability that supports the warfight and what we do, building readiness, readiness through strength and every technical readiness, lethality concerning the infantry, whatever you do. You know, it's up to us to be the visionaries for that. It's up to us to promote our enlisted corps. Some of us may think we're more disadvantaged than others, but that just, to me, that just sounds like more of a challenge for you that might think that. So we're always going to promote ourselves. I would ask that we promote ourselves by way of getting at first what we do, and that's securing a nation. I hope I've given some examples, you know, through what we've tried to do with an Army medicine, being more efficient to bring you in to make you ready, being more ready to go far forward and save lives on the battlefield. So that's my challenge to you.
Absolutely.
So, where's Sergeant Major? Hey, so great point. Great point. Hey, here's some stuff for you. Hey, soldier for life. Soldier for life's important. And so, I mean, if you want to have, if you just can't, hey, I'm retiring and I show up with your hands on your hips and I'm here. I mean, people aren't going to hire you because of that. And I'll tell you, how many were in the soldier and NCO the lunch yesterday? Soldier and NCO. Hey, if you weren't proud to be a non-commissioned officer after General Grange spoke, I mean, there's no, I mean, you ain't got no pride in you. So that's kind of what sergeants major do. Hey, there are colonels that get out of the Army. Here's what Soldier for Life will tell you. There are colonels that get out of the Army every day that they have to take a entry-level or mid-grade management position. And so, hey, one, soldier for life, prepare yourself, be prepared, go through the transition process, have a good resume, set expectations, and when you get, because civilian companies do not have a sergeant major equivalent position, so that's why they don't understand it, okay? They don't have it. So when you get in there, hey, set your expectations, go in and get a job, and show value. And that's when you'll get it promoted much quicker than your counterpart that goes in at the same level with your experience. But you got a soldier for life.
Sergeant Jagger, you had a point too. Thanks, Sergeant.
Hey, let me close out that anything else? Any other comments or questions? Let me just summarize real quickly. One, on the last point, I want to share this with you and you take from it what you want. When we did these general officer interviews, one of the most common themes by the general officers we interviewed, some of them are your bosses, I guess a couple of them are all of our bosses, but one of the common themes is the role of the sergeant major is unique to my organization. No one else can do it. So I think that you have to understand the expectation of you, that they believe, for the most part, that the sergeant major position is principal to the organization, that it is a requirement, that it is necessary. And the only person that can do or fulfill that role is someone that has your experience. So I tell you that because I truly believe the Army sees your position as unique, as a requirement, and is very important to the organization. So as the Army goes, I think you will see trends to develop. For example, in my time, you did not see nearly as many senior level, former enlisted Army civilians as you see today. Still a lot of work to be done there, a lot of place to go, but the instance of that situation occur more frequently now. I agree completely with what the sergeant major said. You have to change that paradigm. We can do that by developing regulatory requirements, by making, as Sergeant Major Edgar said, a definitive role and responsibility document for the sergeant major so others can view that as well. But that's something we have to change ourselves together as a team. Lastly, I'll tell you, you saw Sergeant Major Tom, Sergeant Major Egger, myself, the SMA, and the whole team up here really focused in the same direction. We don't do any one thing in a vacuum. Our education program links to our talent management and assignment process. The nominative sergeant major selection panel links back to our education processes. So it's a very deliberate, very educated process to get us to where we are now. Your input, you can email me or call me anytime, and I'll take a look at what you have to say relative to what I do and determine if we can put it in someplace, if it's relative. Any closing comments, Sergeant Major?
Yeah, okay. Is this on? Thank you. Hey, I just wanted to make sure everyone's tracking. Sergeant Major Management Division has only been around since June. That's when it went into IOC. But a lot of great things have happened in that short period of time. But I need some help from the field. I need some help from all of you. So let's start off with Sergeant Major Schroeder, who to call. I got no issue if you want to call your ACOM Sergeant Major. In fact, I highly encourage it. But the truth is, from 1 year out, and this is for every Sergeant Major from the sixth level all the way through the nominative, 1 year out of your P cord, you're going to get a phone call from the Sergeant Major branch. And they're going to start asking for input from you of what you want to do, if you're going to retire, what your thoughts are. After that, I want that input from those nominative Sergeant Majors saying this individual really needs to continue towards X, or this individual really should be looking it out. He's already capped out. I need that input, not just from the individuals on what they want to do, but from the nominative Sergeant Major saying this is what should happen with this individual. We will take that input and we will put it into the Sergeant Major database as an official part of the record. I need that from you. If we're going to make this work, it's got to be fully involved with everybody, not just the guys that you selected to come over there. We can't do it one-sided. The only thing that's going to happen after that is we'll start getting blamed for stuff. I need your input. So send us. A year out, we're going to contact them. 11 months out, I'm expecting something from you guys to come in and say, hey, this individual really needs to move on towards this. And that's about it. If you haven't got that, if you haven't gotten contact by 11 months, or that individual hasn't gotten contact by 11 months, call me, email me. I will make sure that something happens. Huh?
You haven't been there long enough. You're going to get blamed no matter what.
That's what I'm talking about.
No matter what.
Huh? That's all I got.
All right, Team Hay, a lot of information on this. And of course, you know, we can talk about some of the leader development initiatives that the team's going. We only focus on very seniors right now. The reason why we have to do that is because we've made some mistakes in the past. We got to go top down because we got to create an environment, create the end state in order to create a leader development progressive and sequential to get there. And that stuff's all working simultaneously. So nothing is waiting for that to happen. We just didn't have enough time to cover it today. Hey, so I appreciate your attendance here today. What I'd like to do is two quick paid announcements, one from me, and then Sergeant Major Davenport, and then we're going to release you. First one is we have the senior enlisted readiness form, professional military form this afternoon at 1500, right? 1500. And you'll get to hear more of Command Sergeant Major Scott Schroeder. I'm pretty excited about it myself. I know that you are too. Along with Command Sergeant Major Jim Sims and Command Sergeant Major Jerry Ecker. So they'll be up there talking about readiness. And need you over there, too, to some very controversial topics. We're going to talk about non-deployables. We're going to talk about APFTs, you know, what it takes to stay in the Army in the future, what the requirements are, what are viable sustainability of all those stuff. So look forward to seeing you over there. And then, Dave, you have a paid announcement, right, for the Warrior Corner.
Okay, so one of those initiatives that we talked about yesterday at the early morning forum, is the digital job book, the digital rucksack, and ACT apps. Don't forget, tomorrow afternoon, 12:30 Wednesday, at the Warriors Corner, we're going to release them. They're going to have a live demonstration, so I think it's going to be worth your time to get some of our NCOs down there to see that. And then the last thing I want to plug is, since I got the microphone, is the next town hall is 3 November. We've changed the time. We heard from the forest about doing it a little earlier. So it's going to be 11:30 Eastern time. 11:30 Eastern time. Plug in. The subject is this town hall is on line of effort 2, which is talent management. And we're going to talk a lot about the opportunities that are there for our non-commissioned officers. We're going to have HRC on the net. We're going to have West Point on the net to talk about opportunities for our young soldiers. So look forward to seeing you all there. And if you haven't read the NCO 2020 strategy, it's hung on the line as well.
All right, Sergeants, thank you for your attendance today. And thanks for everything you do. Army strong.